Good afternoon. Welcome to the Middle East Forum's webinar and podcast series, Israel Insider with Ashley Perry. I'm Stacey Roman, and I will be moderating this discussion today. We are pleased to have Mr. Ashley Perry, advisor to the Middle East Forum's Israel office, join us here each Wednesday at 3 p.m. Eastern to update us on all the events going on in Israel. Mr. Perry will be giving us a briefing on current Israeli affairs for 15 minutes, then open it up for questions. Should you wish to ask a question, please use the Q&A box located at the bottom of your screen to type your question. And now, with no further ado, I'll turn the discussion over to Mr. Ashley Perry.
Thank you very much, Stacey, and good evening from Israel. Last time we met, we tried to focus very specifically on one issue, which was the so-called citizenship law, which encountered a lot of challenges in the end, didn't pass. So we looked at that as a sort of paradigm for where this government is going, how long it could last, what its weaknesses are, and certainly that episode exposed them, and also what the opposition, the former coalition's plan strategy is a little bit. Today we're going to touch on that a little bit more, and we're going to start with really something quite remarkable. As we speak, Prime Minister Naftali Bennett is trying to arrange a time where he can go and visit the United States for very important meetings with President Biden and, you know, many other officials. On the agenda will certainly be Iran. That will be number one. But also just sort of getting to know you. Obviously, they've met in the past, but not in their respective positions as president and prime minister. So it's a very important meeting. Usually these meetings, you meet with the head, you know, the head of the house, leaders from both parties, other senior decision makers, et cetera, et cetera. The problem that he has, Naftali Bennett, is that as opposed to the usual way governments work, when a minister, let alone a prime minister, has to travel abroad, usually what happens, or anyone who has to travel abroad, members of Knesset travel in usual times, travel abroad frequently, what happens is, and we talked about that in the past, there's something called kizuz, which is offsetting. If a member of the coalition is unable to attend a vote, then someone of the opposition will step aside or step out or not vote, and vice versa. It's just a well-known tradition. It's protocol. It's shows respect that, you know, no side is trying to gain an unfair advantage, because obviously the coalition with ministers, etc., will obviously need to be out of the country a lot more than the opposition, which don't hold any formal positions and don't tend to go on formal state visits. But the problem is, because it's such a narrow margin, as we've said before, it's something like 61 to 59, the opposition has decided that they will not give any kizuz. And we spoke about this last time, that even a bereaved brother, a member of Knesset from New Hope, whose sister died, was forced to return to the Knesset 2 hours after the burial, because they were so worried that the opposition were going to try and push through a vote while he was absent and then upset the very slim majority the coalition has. But now it could actually harm national security. We have a situation where Naftali Bennett needs to be in the US, needs to meet with President Biden and other senior officials, but has to be back for at least Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, which are the most crucial Knesset days. Don't forget, we have a sitting prime minister who is religious. And even if he wasn't religious, it's standard practice that a prime minister does not hold official meetings on the Sabbath or Shabbat, unless, you know, it really is a life or death situation, like during a war, conflict, or something like that. But then obviously in the US, it's not protocol, it's not standard for the president to hold meetings on a Sunday, because that's the day of rest there. So we're talking about extremely limited opportunities, because the opposition will not agree to the prime minister leaving, will not allow him to even leave and not attend one vote. They won't allow any of their members to offset this. And so they're busy trying to find a time where the two can meet and discuss all these important issues. And really that just goes to the bottom of the animosity between the coalition and the opposition at this point. We saw today some bizarre scenes of an opposition, which holds some right-wing parties, voting against a very right-wing bill. something which they would certainly have supported in any other normal time, about not giving citizenship to terrorists, which makes sense. And it's something that Ayelet Shaked and many others in the coalition would have supported. In fact, it would have probably received very strong support, but it was voted down. On another issue, again, just to show how bizarre the situation is, on issues of security and diplomacy, yes, even in relatively quote-unquote normal times, you don't want to give the coalition a win, but there are so many issues which are not considered, you know, coalition or opposition, they just should be bipartisan. These sort of issues come up all the time in the Knesset. You know, you're lucky even if you get 20 or 30 people vote for it, and very little opposition. Today there was a vote on how long after someone has been subjected to rape, they have a test to check if they have been raped and by who, et cetera, not to go into the details of it, but they basically wanted to extend the time that the police hold this specimen. They want to extend it longer to give people more time to investigate and others to come forward, et cetera, et cetera. It's a very straightforward law, which pretty much, again, I can't imagine there would be too much opposition. The government had to ensure that every single one of its members came to vote and they received the 61 to 59, which is a bizarre situation that 59 members of Knesset voted against something which should have been standard. But this just shows where we are today. There is so much animosity, the screaming at the Knesset back and forth goes on, the name calling is incessant. It just ramps up almost every single day, and it's reached the level we saw this week. Prime Minister Bennett, former Prime Minister Netanyahu, were attacking each other, you know, some might argue like school children, just back and forth, really the name calling. And Naftali Bennett, Prime Minister Bennett, returned an expression that Netanyahu had called him before when he was sitting in the opposition, that him and his allies are chamutzim, which means the sour pusses. So today or the other day, Naftali Bennett called Netanyahu chamutzim and sour pusses. But there was a real slangy match back and forth, because in the Knesset, the prime minister was instructed, there's a rule in the Knesset that if you receive 40 signatures, you force the prime minister to attend a special session where he has to answer questions from other members of Knesset. And obviously that will be done regularly. And the leader of the opposition at the moment, former Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, basically took opportunity back and forth to respond to everything that Bennett said. And there was really nasty accusations. And these accusations weren't just during that Knesset session, they've gone all week. There's been accusations back and forth. Who was strong and who was tough on Hamas? Who was strong and who was weak on Iran? Netanyahu continued the accusations against Prime Minister, keep forgetting who's in, Bennett, saying that he and Foreign Minister and alternate Prime Minister Yair Lapid have agreed not to surprise the Americans. Something which, by the way, former Prime Minister Netanyahu did on many, many occasions. You know, between allies, you don't tend to surprise each other on the whole. Prime Minister Netanyahu took this off-the-cuff sort of comment that wasn't even registered in the US's press release, that basically they wouldn't act on Iran without American say-so, which obviously is less likely to come. And he's been attacking this government, again, for something which he did numerous times over numerous years. But this is a point he's trying to attack the government. Also, we've seen a resurgence of COVID infections, corona infections over the last couple of weeks. Now, it's probably more than anything else a coincidence that the Delta variant, which is running through Israel at the moment, happened to arrive, actually arrived the first time during the Netanyahu coalition, but certainly has risen over the last few weeks. Netanyahu has been almost joyous, the fact that he's been able to blame the coalition and said, we beat coronavirus and within a few weeks it's back with a vengeance. It's clearly, you know, not necessarily anything the government did, and there's a lot of steps that the government has taken, like at the airport, which the previous government wasn't able to do, but it's certainly considered a great concern in Israel. The numbers are starting to go up. Again, there's a whole debate in Israel, as is happening in the UK and many other places, which number should really define the conversation? Should it be the numbers of infections every day, the numbers of positive cases, or should it be the numbers of serious cases? Because in this wave, we certainly see a large distance between the two. What we saw in previous waves is a very direct correlation, but in this wave, certainly less, probably largely to do with the significant vaccination rates in Israel. But there is a lot of pressure on this government. This government, don't forget, when they were in the opposition, they slammed the government and even some of the people like current education minister, Shasha Biton, was a big critic of the government from within the government. And they used to be very against a lot of the closures, a lot of the severe restrictions. So this government is sticking to that to a certain extent and basically not trying to put restrictions. They are restricting things at the airport. They're trying to make that as tight as possible and advising people not to travel at all, if possible, giving people fines if they go to certain countries, giving others when they return from certain countries to go into isolation and making sure that everyone has a test in an orderly and quick fashion. So in that respect, they've certainly got things in order. But the fact is that they haven't yet added any restrictions within Israel. And there are calls from the opposition that, and even from health officials, that it is time to act and it's very necessary. So that is something that that is becoming part of the conversation here. There's, everything is being used between the coalition and the opposition to attack each other. And there's no shortage of issues. So we have to ask, what is the strategy of Netanyahu and his colleagues? At the moment, they haven't really, even though the citizenship law didn't pass, and it's certainly struggling to pass in the future, they haven't really made any great dents in the coalition. And really, we know that there's only really two ways for this government to fall. The first is a no confidence vote. For that, you need to put up an alternative government and have 61 members. And as we know, the opposition, Netanyahu and his allies, are only 53 seats. There's the joint Arab list, which is six, which obviously there isn't much coordination, although there's more coordination between those groups than they either would like to admit. But to get to 61, there would mean some of the coalition to vote against, to basically end this government and their positions in the government, et cetera. So that's not going to happen at the moment. So the major point where this government could be broken up is, we know from the previous governments, is the budget that doesn't pass on time. Now, the government did vote for an extension to the budget, and the budget has to be passed by November. And that's really where the big fight is. It really is. Everything else is sort of just to get, things in order, to try and delegitimize the government, to try to show it's not effective, to try to show the inconsistencies within the government. But really the big fight will be on the budget. So what the government, what the opposition is trying to do, is trying to give the government a taste of this by these massive filibusters, by trying to bring up every single little point and drawing it out, by attacking every single thing, by trying to get as much of that 59 seat opposition, as I said, we're talking about Netanyahu allies and the joint Arab list, to every single vote. And you may say, well, November's quite a long time to pass the budget. Well, don't forget, within a couple of weeks, this government will go, this Knesset will go on a summer recess. And then when it returns, there is the Jewish holidays, which take up most of September. So then you've really got October to pass what is quite a large undertaking. It's not just a simple one vote on the budget. Every line in it has to be discussed. There has to be arrangements committee. There has to be discussions. There has to be votes. It's quite an arduous process. And don't forget, you need to have 61, really focused members of Knesset without anyone getting ill. Today, we saw a member of Yesh Atid becoming ill. So they had to basically close any voting. They had to put off any votes that they were going to have today, because with one Yesh Atid MK testing positive for coronavirus, basically they didn't have the majority to pass anything. Ironically, if you like, the Speaker of the Knesset, a member of Yesh Atid himself, Miki Levy, actually departed from protocol from the last Knesset, where even if you tested positive, you're allowed to come to a certain area, closed off area, to vote Well, he basically didn't want to do that. He'd been advised by health officials. So we see, you know, that that any single person, whatever the case may be, whether they're ill, whether they're out of the country, can bring something down. So you can imagine trying to vote a budget with all the different line disagreements and every single issue turned over and over again. It's not going to be an easy task. But Finance Minister Viktor Liebmann has said that he'll present the first draft of the budget bill in August. And he is certainly hopeful. I spoke with him last week. He's certainly hopeful that the budget will be able to pass this. As I've said many times before, there's a lot of goodwill amongst the leaders. That's certainly being tested. Even today, there was a cannabis bill, a bill to legalize a small amount of cannabis for personal use. And there's wall-to-wall support in the coalition to do so, except for the Ram Party, Mansour Abbas, on religious reasons. And they thought that this wouldn't be a problem. They argued, but he's standing firm on this. So the fact that Yesh Atid MK wasn't able to come and they put off the votes anyway actually worked in their favor. But it shows that even on issues they thought that they had general agreement, there's still a certain amount of work to do. So the situation in the Knesset is not getting any more pleasant, let's say. It's not getting any less adversarial at the moment. And again, while everything that's happening now is just a sort of hors d'oeuvre, as it were, the main meal, the one that everybody's focused on, is the budget, because that's where the fight, and that's the real possibility of bringing down this government. And with that, I'm happy to answer any questions on this or anything else.
All right, thank you so much. So the first question we have is, will the voting outcomes change, or is the going to be fairly standard with the outcomes based on the animosity in the government? Essentially, will the opposition ever drop their goal of undermining the coalition and vote for what's best for the country?
Not at the moment. There could be situations where we start to see cracks on either side. What is important to note is that there is some leeway on some things. So I'll give you an example. First of all, the government, I keep on talking about 61 to 59, well, actually, really, in theory, Yamina have an extra seat, which is Shikli, which we've spoken about before. He has said that he will vote with the government on certain issues. He even said at one point the majority of issues, and probably on many of the issues in the budget. So they have one there. Yisrael Beiteinu also have a rogue MK, Eli Avidar. So far, he's voting mostly with the government on most issues, but he doesn't consider himself beholden to the government. So again, that could be even one less. Where many of these votes can come down to is where the joint list stands. Because as I've said, Netanyahu and his allies, his strong allies, which are the two ultra-Orthodox parties and religious Zionist parties, only reaches 53. To get to 59, they need to have cooperation with the joint Arab list, which they have called all manner of things before, and ideologically, obviously, very opposing. But they understand that they have to work together, and they are working together. So these numbers mean that there's not always going to be 59-61, but probably on a lot of issues it is. Whether some members of Netanyahu's coalition are going to come over on some issues, at the moment, no. They are being extremely disciplined, even though they say that they disagree with some of these laws, and likewise on the other side. At the moment, both sides are being pretty disciplined. There hasn't been any votes, sort of swap over votes. There have been some abstentions, very minimal here and there. People who haven't turned up to vote, again, minimally here and there. But on the whole, there hasn't been any coalition members who have voted for an opposition bill, and likewise.
Understood. Thank you. From Marie Feldman, if the U.S. rejoins the JCPOA, will this government work covertly with Saudi Arabia, the UAE, et cetera, to get nuclear weapons to offset the power of Iran? To offset the power of Iran.
Will they work together? I mean, if they're working together.
With Saudi Arabia, UAE, to get nuclear weapons to offset the power of Iran.
Will Israel be helping Saudi Arabia and UAE to get nuclear weapons? No. It certainly wouldn't be in Israel's interest if there are any other players in the region with nuclear weapons. And to have more countries nuclear weapons basically mean an arms race in the region, which would certainly put Israel's situation far more in peril. And don't forget that Israel always has to look not just what happens today, but in 5 or 10 years. So whereas today we have a very friendly regime in the UAE and a relatively friendly regime in Saudi Arabia, Israel's seen the region change overnight too many times to think that that could that will be that way forever. There's certainly a lot of shared interests, and the biggest shared interest obviously is at the moment is on Iran, and there is a lot of work being done at all levels between those nations and others that you mentioned, but I don't see that necessarily moving into the point where Israel will help some of its allies acquire nuclear weapons.
Thank you. From Reuven Hawk, given the recent poll by the Jewish Democratic Council of America showing the high percentages of American Jews who consider Israel to be an apartheid state and committing genocide against the Palestinians, do you think that the current Israeli government will take this seriously and improve its information campaign?
Well, I hope so, obviously, and I'm sure there are a lot of people who'll be looking at this. You know, every poll like this is, it should be a worry, not because Israel is any of these things that it's accused of, but because there is a younger generation of Jews, let alone non-Jews in America, who are buying this. And even though it's not the majority, it's not even a large plurality, it's still, I think it was 20-25% on the apartheid terminology who agreed with that. I think that certainly should be a worry for Israel. And I think, you know, there'll be a lot of ministries, the foreign ministry, which deals with some of these issues, diaspora affairs ministry, which should certainly be looking at these figures and thinking how we can get our information out better. Because it's clear that, you know, that there's a partisan nature to support for Israel, or to be a sympathy for Israel at the moment. And I think we have to work very hard in Israel to try and regain the support of the Democratic Party. You know, there are certain members, don't get me wrong, you know, there are certain members of the Democratic Party which will be far, if not impossible, to bring over. We know who we're talking about here. But there's the mainstream Democratic Party who are sympathetic. And by the way, there was a delegation who were here recently, and the language they used was very familiar and warming to Israelis. So it's not the whole Democratic Party. It's not even the mainstream Democratic Party. It's really the extreme that is using their voice from Congress really to malign Israel. And unfortunately, this seems to be seeping into the consciousness of at least a part of younger American Jewry. And certainly we have to think very hard in Israel at all levels how we combat this. And it is through greater information and really explaining Israel's story far better than we've done up to this point.
Thank you for that. From Bob Larrick, are there any efforts at bringing about better human relations within Israel and or with some of the countries Israel has normalized relations with, such as Jordan and Egypt?
Are you talking about people to people relations? Is that, if I understand the question correctly? Jordan and Egypt, I would say, are very different from the UAE. And some of the other countries that Israel's normalized relations with. Jordan and Egypt has been a largely cold peace. Obviously, Egypt since the late 70s and Jordan since the early 90s. There hasn't been too much people-to-people interaction. During the early years of both of these peace agreements, there was far more optimism to a larger or lesser extent, fraternity between the peoples. But largely today, these are peace agreements between the leaders. You know, the way it is now with the UAE is certainly far more friendly. You know, there's a lot more Israelis who are visiting the Emirates, even Morocco, and there's a lot of attempts to try and sign agreements in culture, in sports, in people-to-people relations, so that, you know, that this is definitely a tremendous opportunity for far more sort of breaking these barriers of leadership, just a cold peace between leaders, to something a lot more on the ground that the people feel. And the amount of planes that are going into Abu Dhabi and Dubai really just show the difference between the older agreements and the new agreements under the Abraham Accords. And I think that there's definite efforts to try and not just keep this at the highest levels, not even at the ministerial levels, not even at the sort of the think tank levels or something like that, but also amongst the people. So we are seeing something different. You know, there are attempts here and there to try and do something with Jordan and Egypt, and you know, but they're on a far smaller scale.
Thank you. And from Barak Korkmaz, what can we expect about the future of Israel-Turkey relations?
Well, there were certainly attempts by President Erdogan to try and see if there can be some new chapter. You know, he reached out to, I believe, both Prime Minister Bennett and new President Herzog. But there has to be a lot more than just a sort of congratulatory conversation. I mean, you know, we've seen even in recent days, recent weeks, that Turkey has not lowered its rhetoric against Israel in support of, you know, terrorist groups. It houses certain leaders of Hamas and other problematic players in the region. It funds, it incites, it inspires some very problematic things. So I think that at the moment, Israel's sort of waiting to see if there is this interest to actually turn a new leaf, or it's just really window dressing and congratulatory messages.
Thank you. Sandro Bellestrino asks, how do you think the impending implosion of Afghanistan will affect Israel?
I don't think too much. I mean, not more than it has been for a number of years. Afghanistan hasn't been much of a functioning state for many years. We're slightly out of that conflict. You know, it is in our wider neighborhood, and there are players involved, levels of influence here in the immediate region. But it's certainly not something that any country in the region or any player who's involved with Afghanistan want to see happening. But Israel is not really at that level where it can do anything about it, or really necessarily feel the greater effects of it any more than the last year or the year before, I would suggest, not being an expert on Afghanistan.
Understood, thank you. Murray Feldman again, please comment on Lieberman cutting daycare dollars from the ultra-Orthodox.
Right, so that was also an issue that came up this week. Finance Minister Lieberman, as he has promised, he's going to cut some of the subsidies and welfare payments or whatever it is to the ultra-Orthodox community, specifically those who are in full-time learning. He's very much of the belief that there's a need to incentivize greater numbers into the workforce. And obviously one of those communities which has much lower numbers in the workforce is the ultra-Orthodox community. So one of the ways that he felt was a way to save some money for the budget, and also to incentivize greater numbers into the workforce, was to, at the moment, if you have one working parent, then you can get free daycare for kids at a young age. But what he's now decided to do is that it will only be given to those where both parents are working. And in the ultra-Orthodox worlds, the woman works more often than not, whereas the man will be in full-time learning. And if the state pays for that, then there's no incentive to go out and work. And his view is that there should be more people going out to work. So you don't pay people not to work, you incentivize them and you give them more benefits when they do work. So that's something that came up. There was a big backlash, as you can imagine, in the ultra-Orthodox community and its allies. Interestingly enough, while they did bash Lieberman, they tried to put more pressure on Bennett and Prime Minister Bennett. And Prime Minister Bennett is very sensitive to these issues, not just because he's a religious person. His worldview is certainly far from the ultra-Orthodox, but you know, there's a feeling that he understands at one point in the future, he will need to work with the ultra-Orthodox again. So he is someone who is stopping a lot of what Lieberman, Lapid, and others would like to do to cut even more benefits to the ultra-Orthodox. So there was quite a backlash against Bennett and a lot of work behind the scenes to try and get him on side and trying to make sure that this, you know, this will maybe be the first and last. There was a lot of pressure. A lot of people felt that the warning for this, considering it would start at the beginning of the school year in September, was a little bit too soon, too quickly. So Lieberman has now decided to put it off to November to give people more time to go out and find work. But that is an important issue, because the ultra-Orthodox, as we've spoken about many times, are very keen to get into the government. The fact that they bash them and call Lieberman evil and Bennett not religious and all these sort of things doesn't discount the fact that behind closed doors, they are very much trying to get in. At the moment, they are not. There's talk that maybe after the budget, once the budget's been passed, maybe it'll be easier for them to join. But that's obviously not something that they want, because they would certainly want to ensure that the budgets that they've been receiving for many years to ensure their community learns and doesn't work, but still gets subsidized for that remains. But probably in the budget, there'll be a few steps that will be taken in that direction, but certainly not as much as there were in previous years. And Lieberman himself has said, you know, there's no way we can do everything we want to. It has to be a staged process. But the fact that he came out with this, there was all this debate whether Bennett was informed about it, whether he did it on his own. And that's something which very much is on the mind of a lot of coalition watchers, to see exactly how much coordination there is, how far they will go, because, the war against these subsidies, these extra subsidies for the ultra-Orthodox community, is a major issue for some of the major players in the coalition. And maybe there's this good cop, bad cop sort of play being played out. But that's something which certainly has to be watched, to see how far we'll go, how many measures or steps will be taken to try and incentivize and bring more people to workforce, and whether the ultra-Orthodox are going to continue knocking the door, and whether that door will eventually be opened for them.
Hey, well, thank you so much. We've come to the close of our webinar and podcast. Ashley, thank you again for taking time to update us this week. For our viewers, please join us Friday for the kickoff of our new series featuring MEF project directors and specialists in their respective fields. Thank you all for joining us, and I hope you have a great day.